This conference will now be recorded.
A very good evening to one and all present here. I'm Ms. Neha Mahajan, Executive Organizer. On behalf of BioSetup Life Sciences, take this honor to welcome our Founder Coordinator, Argedeep Das, sir. Event Coordinators, Dr. Sudeep Das, Dr. Kavita Paul, and our today's eminent guest speaker, Dr. Subhendu Bandyopadhyay. Faculty members, organizers, and all my dear student participants, I welcome you all for the webinar on the topic Climate Resilient Crops for the Future, organized by BioSetup Life Sciences. I hope you all are good and safe at your end. Before starting this session, a humble request to all the participants, please do not share your audio, video, and screen sharing in order to avoid any kind of disturbance. If you have any doubt during the session, please use the chat box. Filling of the feedback form is mandatory. Now, let me tell you about BioSetup Life Sciences. BioSetup Life Sciences is a hub of scientific research and learning approved by ISO 9001:2015 certified organization and also MSME registered under Government of India. We have multidisciplinary team of eminent and experienced faculty members and research associates that provide support to aspiring students in life sciences. We have successfully organized many webinars, workshops, internship programs, e-training program, certification courses, career counseling, and competitive exam preparations such as CSIR, IIT JAM, GATE B, IISc, DBT. We are continuously working for the career improvement of students. As we all are aware, we have been facing difficult times during the ongoing pandemic since 2 years, but we believe in not stopping and giving quality education to the budding minds through online platform. You must have also heard that the empty rakes makes more noise. So it's important to keep filling the bucket of knowledge to any source available. Keeping this in mind, now I would like to introduce our event coordinator, Dr. Sudeep Das and Dr. Kavita Paul. Dr. Sudeep Das is a lung infection biologist and human microbiome expert and a postdoctoral fellow, University of Lausanne, Switzerland. Currently a holder of highly prestigious Marie Curie Fellowship from the European Union. Dr. Kavita Paul is a scientist at Advanced Center for Treatment Research for Cancer, Tata Memorial Center, Mumbai, India. She has vast experience in the field of nano drug delivery, cancer biology, and clinical studies. Her areas of expertise are nanomedicine, drug delivery system, preclinical and clinical studies. Now I request Ms. Wrinkle to introduce our today's eminent guest speaker. Over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Our today's webinar will be handled by Dr. Subhendu Bandyopadhyay, sir. He's working as assistant professor in Department of Biochemistry, School of Life Science and Biotechnology at MS University. Sir has teaching experience of more than 4 years at UG and PG levels. Sir is expertise in teaching biochemistry, metabolism, proteins, plant biochemistry, bioenergetics, and membrane biology, also biophysical techniques. Sir has more than 5 years of experience as postdoctoral fellow. Has research expertise in plant molecular biology, transgenic plant development and analysis, also plant tissue culture. Sir has more than 12 publications along with one book chapter. Dr. Subhendu Bandyopadhyay, sir, has awarded as the best faculty in Biochemistry Department, School of Life Science and Biotechnology for the session 2018-19 by Adamas University. Sir has cracked CSIR UGC NET exam and GATE exam. Sir has research associateship by Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. Also, research fellowship in science for meritorious students by university grant commissions. Sir has awarded Haridan Basu Memorial Award on NEET plus merit for the Department of Biochemistry, University of Calcutta. Also won first poster presentation in an international symposium on medicinal plants and herbal products in biomedicine and their efficiency in the present era, held in November 2005 at Kolkata, West Bengal. Also awarded Excellent Poster Prize in an international symposium on trends in plant size research held at Kolkata, West Bengal. Sir has also presented a paper at Indian Statistical Institute in the international conference entitled Biodiversity Issues and Concerns. Sir is also a life member of the Society for Plant Biochemistry and Biotechnology, India. Without delaying, I request Mr. Dr. Subendru Bandyopadhyay, sir, to kindly proceed. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Okay. Thank you for the nice introduction. And before I start, I would like to thank the authorities of BioSetup Life Sciences. I know that they are new in this area, but they are doing a very good job, and I wish them great success for their future. Now, today I am going to discuss about a very important issue, which is affecting our present and which is going to affect our future in a very hard way. So the title of my topic is Climate Resilient Crops for the Future. So this topic, climate resilient crop or climate resilience agriculture, this is nothing new. If you go back 10 to 20 years back, you will also find that climate resilient agriculture or climate resilient crops, these have surfaced at that time, and there were pretty much work going on in international and national scenario on this particular topic. But then why we are discussing it now? Because is it clear now? Is my voice clear?
Yes, sir.
You're audible.
Okay. So why we are discussing it now, whether when this particular topic is already 20 or 30 years old? Because the environmental situation that we are facing now, the climatic change that we are facing now, this is the high time to discuss about this particular topic. And how we can cope up with the climate change, with the environmental pollution that we are facing now. So that's why I have chosen to talk about this. And this is very contemporary topic, because as I will discuss, you will find that several works is going on in this particular area, and several initiatives from our government also taking place. And here in this particular area, not only government, but also government and farmers and scientists, all of them have their effective share of contribution, and they are contributing. And how they are contributing and how we can cope up with this new evil that we are facing, that I am going to discuss in my talk. So let us start with the definition of climate. What is climate? Climate is a cumulative pattern of weather of a particular area for about 20 or 30 years. So it means that climate change cannot be made in a very frequent way. Then why are we really concerned about this particular thing? Because climate change is now occurring at a faster speed. and why it is occurring at a faster speed due to different type of environmental pollution. And we all know that learning this particular subject of environmental pollution is related to climate change. Recent activities in our local area can easily give you a realization that how important this climate change thing is, because we are seeing now very frequent cases of cyclone, flood, devastation created by nature. So now how these are so frequent? This is because this thing is controlled by the very quick degradation of our environment. That's why in recent usage, especially in the context of environmental policy, the term climate change is often coming, and we are really concerned about this particular climate change. So what is actually climate change? So climate change, actually it includes both global warming and the resulting large scale shifts of weather patterns in our area. And it is very important thing, as it encompasses all the scientific, economic, political and social interventions, because we know that our Mother Earth is giving us life. It is supporting life. And if anything that is changing its climate, then it is certainly going to affect us. So for some thinkers, they are actually not telling it as climate change. They are actually telling it as climate crisis. And we need to address this crisis right now. So there are several ways that we can address this crisis, and I will talk about them one by one. But now first let us see what are the different drivers that are actually making this climate change fast. So the main driver is the recent temperature rise. So here three different graphs are there, three different pictures are there. I will slowly explain all of them. So the main cause of the recent temperature rise is the emission of huge amount of greenhouse gases. Whatever precautions we are taking, the greenhouse emission is very high in our Mother Earth. So here in this particular picture, you can see that temperature change in the last 50 years that is occurring, and they are showing that at high alarming rate this particular temperature change is occurring. And this temperature change is occurring now in a much more higher way, as you can see that this is the carbon dioxide concentration in Mother Earth. And after the Industrial Revolution, this particular thing is increasing day by day, and it has increased many fold. That's why this huge concentration of carbon dioxide is going inside our atmosphere. And we know that carbon dioxide, methane, all these gases which are emitted by different industries or different vehicles, they are actually greenhouse gases. And what they do, they artificially heat our environment, and from that artificially heating, the temperature of our Earth is going up. Another very important aspect of this temperature rise is that our changes of the land surface, that the global tree cover is, we are losing the annual tree cover regular basis. Although for the modernization of our civilization, we have to cut some forest for make out more and more cultivable land. We are cutting some forest and making them cultivable land, but the forestry cover, it is a very good sink of carbon dioxide that we are emitting day by day. So if you are cutting this forest, then there will be a sharp increase in carbon dioxide that we are making. So from this graph, you can easily see that from 2015 to 2020, in a very bigger proportion, we have got loss of tree cover. So this is very alarming, and all these things actually making the temperature of the earth rise. And that temperature rise is changing the climate very quickly. So what are the major impacts that we can have due to this climate change? So shifting in precipitation pattern, very important. So if the temperature is very high, so what happens? That there will be shift in precipitation patterns, either heavy rain, or there will be less rain. So if there will be heavy rain, then it will increase in flooding, and that can cause crop damage, water pollution, soil erosion. If there is less rain, so it drought levels, which affect plant survival and increase the risk of wildfires. Then it, if increase in temperature, average levels, it will affect the plant cycles, the life cycles of plant, and it will lead to early blooming, lesser pollination, and frost damage. So we have to cope up with that. So farmers, what they do, they develop on the degraded soil, they develop crop factories. Crop factories means they are one type of plant or crop they are planting. So only monoculture cropping system is going on. So that is again degrading the soil quality. Then industrial agriculture lacks biodiversity. What crop factories do, they actually plant a single type of crop so that they can get commercial gain. And in that way, they are losing the biodiversity, which affects plant viability. Then heavy fertilizer use and pesticide use will be there when there will be no soil fertility. So it will cause water pollution and exposure to chemicals and higher cost for farmers. So in a nutshell, we can say that the impact will be very heavy if climate change occurs at this particular rate. Now, the climate change actually, it is affecting all forms of life, but we are considering the plant life, the main domain which is actually helpful for sustaining the human civilization. Because without plants, we all know that there will be no food and we cannot survive. So the thing is that how plants actually respond to this climate change, that we need to know. So there are several several ways that that the climate change is affecting the plant physiology. It can affect its metabolism. It can affect the physiology. It can affect the soil fertility, so that indirectly the plant can be affected. It can affect the microbial activity of the soil. So the interrelationship between good bacteria, soil living good bacteria, and the plant, that is prohibited. And it will also inhibit the diversity. So in one way, we can say that this climate change will limit plant growth and productivity, and ultimately food production. This is very important and very alarming thing. So now let us see that what is the negative impact on. So in a survey, scientists have proved that now this is 2010 to 2029. So we can see that at a range of almost 10 to 25% crop loss that is occurring due to climate change. And if we take it forward at this rate, then after 40 to 50 years, it will be here, and we can see that the prediction is almost 50 to 100% loss of crop yield. That means, according to this prediction, there will be no food, or acute food crisis will occur at this particular time. So this is really frightening. So to check this particular situation, to cope up with the climate change that is occurring very frequently, we have to develop climate resilient agriculture. What is climate resilient agriculture? It is actually an approach that includes sustainably using existing natural resources through crop and livestock production system to achieve long-term higher productivity and farm incomes under climate variabilities. So what are the components of this climate resilient agriculture? The components are, we can develop tolerant crops. Tolerant crop means which will be tolerant to the ill effects of climate change. So whatever climate change will occur, it will tolerate that, and it will continue producing the thing. The water management. If we use different type of latest technologies water management, then we can use less water to develop more crop. And that is actually the philosophy of the per drop more crop, this particular initiative taken by the government of India. We can talk to the agro advisory boards. Agro advisory boards are agro advisory board comprising of several government officials and different specialists of different area, in which there are climatologists, there are scientists, there are farmers. And by taking this agro advisory board suggestions, what we can do, we can regularly check the climate pattern, the weather pattern, and according to that pattern, we can develop crops, we can sow crops, and we can take necessary precautionary measure so that crop loss should not occur. So this agro advisory board measure can be taken up. So keeping in mind all these things, our government of India has designed several plans, and these plans are already taking place, already going for more than 4 or 5 years, some of them, like this NAPCC, this National Action Plan on Climate Change, then PMKSY, then Green India Mission, Soil Health Card Scheme. All these schemes are designed and developed by Government of India, and these are now going on for some time. So now let us come to our main topic, the climate resilient crops. So what is this climate resilience actually means? So climate resilience means this is an adaptive capacity of a particular system to absorb stress, adapt the stress, whatever stress it is getting, to absorb that, adapt that, and reorganize its system and evolve into more desirable configurations so that it can improve the sustainability of the system. So that it can be prepared for future climate change impacts. So now if we extrapolate this concept to the climate resilient to the crop system, so what will be a climate resilient crop? The climate resilient crop will be those crop varieties which have been recommended as a way for farmers to cope with or adapt to climate change. So this is the main purpose that we are now discussing on, to develop some climate resilient crops so that these crop varieties can adapt to the climate change and it can continue the production as it is doing now. So what are the techniques through which we can develop climate resilient crops? So there are two broad ways with which we can develop these type of crops. The first one is the classical plant breeding, in which the plants are selectively propagated with desirable characteristics and eliminating or culling those with less desirable characteristics. This is very old technique and very effective also to choose crop plants with different desirable characteristics and then interbreed them or cross between them, and then to choose the offspring which is having all those desired characteristics, and then again interbreed them or back cross them with different and then by multiple time this type of crossing we will get a climate resilient crop, or a crop which is which is having these desired traits. So this is called classical plant breeding. And in the modern plant breeding, what we have, modern plant breeding uses the technology of molecular biology to select plants which are actually give a particular plant the resistant property or the tolerant property against a particular stress, like temperature stress or salinity stress or any kind of biotic stress like insect or pest invasion. And then that particular trait we will insert into the plant, and we will propagate the plant with breeding technique or any other technique or micropropagation technique, and then we will arrive to a particular plant which will be a climate resistant or climate resilient plant. So these are the two different techniques. Now let us see what are the different components in these particular techniques. So first we will look at the classical plant breeding. Classical plant breeding, as I have said, what we do in classical plant breeding or conventional breeding, we take plants which are actually having those characteristics which we need. Like here we have taken one high yielding variety that yield a very high amount of the product, and another virus resistant plant which does not have a high yielding characteristic, but it can work against the virus invasion. So now when we are crossing them, we will choose those offsprings which has this virus resistant property, and also they are producing high amount of crop. So only those progeny that we are going to move further. So now what we will do, we will take this desired plant and we will then back cross it with this particular plant, and in this way we will make more and more cycle, and we will get a stable virus resistant and high yield crop. So it means that with the help of crossbreeding and obviously selective crossbreeding, what we are doing, we are producing a particular plant variety which is resistant to a particular biotic stress. So this is called classical plant breeding. Now it has different type of component, like introgression breeding, where a plant has the desirable trait, let's say mildew resistance, is crossed with a plant that doesn't have that trait but is desirable in all other traits. There is a quality control step to make sure that the only change to the original variety is the desired trait. So based on the desired trait, we are actually selecting the progeny and then again back crossing them. Then inbreeding technique, depending on the species, some plants may be fertilized by themselves. So this is done to produce an inbred variety which is exactly the same generation after generation. So why we are doing this? This is to develop true to self clones. We are doing inbreeding. Then hybrid breeding. Sometimes what we do, we take two different inbred varieties and then cross them to produce an offspring with stable characteristics and hybrid vigor. So this will be more in vigor to its parental varieties. So these are the three different ways with which we generally do plant breeding. Now, I would like to tell you one very important example of plant breeding here. So this is the Theosinth parent. Theosinth is the old parent of our this corn. Okay, so this we think the corn that we eat now. So this is actually coming from this Theosinth, which has a very poor yielding plant. But when it was actually crossed with this maize parent by our ancestors, and after so many days it was crossbred, and then the progenies were checked, and then the high yielding progeny were taken, and again it was back crossed, then only we have arrived at this particular position, and now we see this particular thing in its normal form. So it means that this traditional plant breeding has a particular drawback, and that drawback is actually it is very, very time consuming. And the way the climate is changing, the way we are facing these decrease in crop yield and increasing food demand, we cannot wait for that long. So that's why we need faster products, and that should be climate resilient also. So the modern plant breeding, actually modern plant breeding depends on molecular biological techniques, in which through molecular biology, through different molecular markers, we can check out the genes or genetic elements which are actually having those desired traits. Like they can they produce a particular protein which is tolerant to the high temperature or the high salinity or drought condition or some kind of virus infection, all these things. And first we with the help of the molecular marker, we actually identify that particular portion from a particular variety of crop, and then try to come up with that particular gene or QTL, whatever it is. And then we insert that QTL or gene inside our crop variety, crop of interest, and then we develop these kind of crops which are climate resistant by normal crossbreeding. But the molecular biology technique is there at the first place. So that was the marker assisted selection. Then there could be genetic engineering with which we can produce transgenic or genetically modified organism or GMOs, like GM plants, GM crops. And in this particular method, we take help from the tDNA, that is the TI plasmid DNA from Agrobacterium. And within this tDNA, what we do, we clone our gene of interest, and then we insert this tDNA in the Agrobacterium, and then infect this bacteria to the plant cells in a tissue culture media. So what happens that this Agrobacteria has a unique capability of transferring its TI plasmid to the tissue culture plants. So what happens that these embryos or these callus, they take up the tDNA from the Agrobacteria, and they are now the hybrid plants. So these plants are now taken care by the plant tissue culturist, and what they do, they develop this plant breeding technology, they develop these plants, and now these plants are actually called transgenic plants, and they are selected for their desired trait, and they can be propagated for cultivation. So in this way, genetically engineered plants can be developed. Then another technology that has arrived that is called gene editing. Although everything can be considered as gene editing, but more recently with the help of this CRISPR-Cas9 technology, where a sgRNA and this Cas9 enzyme, they are actually make precise cut in the genome and they insert the gene of interest in a particular genome. And from that particular precise editing, we can develop genetically modified crop plants, which are having the desired trait that we have. This is very new strategy. You know that just 1 or 2 years back, this CRISPR-Cas9 system, the discoverer of this CRISPR-Cas9 system, they have got the Nobel Prize also. And this is already revolutionizing the genetic engineering technology. They are scientists are producing lots of products in with animal biotechnology or in plant biotechnology areas. And this is also going to help us in our future endeavors with this climate resilient crops. So this is the latest technology of gene editing with which we can develop climate resilient crops. So what we can say now that sequencing and phenotyping of gene banks can provide superior alleles or haplotypes from different crop varieties. Next gen sequencing and precise phenotyping can be used for fast forward trait mapping, which can be used for the marker assisted selection and breeding purposes. Then pre-breeding is suggested to identify or introduce alleles for climate change traits. Genomic selection and genome editing are the next generation breeding approaches. An integration of different disciplines is required to develop climate resilient crops. So all these technologies that have been developed, they can be amalgamated and used for climate resilient crops. So here is a chart which you can see that that all the different areas of modern biology can be used for developing the this type of climate resilient crops, which will be greater yielding as well as tolerant to the climate change. So genomics, proteomics, epigenomics, transcriptomics, metabolomics, all these data can be used by scientists, and they can develop these type of climate resilient crops. So coming to the Indian scenario, as Indian agriculture system is highly monsoon dependent, so we can easily think that climate change can have a very, very serious effect on Indian agricultural system. So climate change, in an economic survey in 2017-18, it has been found that climate change might be reducing annual agricultural income in the range of 15% to 18% and up to 20% to 25% for unirrigated areas. So there are huge areas which are unirrigated, which are only monsoon dependent, and if anything happens like drought or anything, temperature rise, though there will be severe loss of income. Here are maps of poor winter rain. Just 1 or 2 years back, this particular picture I have taken from, and which can increase dryness, or even excessive rain can affect the flood. So in India, an increase in temperature by 1.5 degrees Celsius and a reduction in the precipitation of 2 mm can reduce the rice yield by 3 to 15%. This is huge. Salinity is another main operator of environmental variation. If there will be flood, there will be the inundation of coastal regions, and all the field will be totally saline, and which will make the cultivation very difficult. Then Government of India, Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, and Indian Council of Agriculture Research has taken several proactive policies that are being implemented at the village level. So taken care of these type of situations, India government is working in a very fast pace now. So it is just 4-5 days before, 2 days before that, almost 1 month ago, that our Honorable Chief Minister has gave 35 varieties. He released 35 varieties which are developed by our different research institutes under Indian Council of Agricultural Research, ICAR body, and they are actually resilient to different climatic changes like drought, like different type of virus invasion and all the other things. So let us just have a short look at what these particulars of these crops. So here I am showing you one crop which is called submergence tolerant rice, and this is called Swarna Sub 1. So this is actually good for those fields which are submerged by flood. So Swarna Sub 1, this is actually developed by DRDO, Defense Research Development Organization, along with help from Indian government. And what they have done, they have introduced this Sub 1, that is Submergence 1 QTL. A QTL is a particular genomic element in which different genes are there which are undefined. That's why it is called quantitative trait loci. So this is actually genetic element which is responsible for a particular trait. So this QTL has been introduced into the rice variety Swarna that actually cannot develop in a flooded area or in a submerged area. So here you can see that in a submerged area Swarna cannot survive, but when this Sub 1 QTL is inserted into this Swarna, then this Swarna Sub 1 variety, this can easily survive and this can produce in a flooded area. So this is one example of plant breeding along with this marker assisted selection or modern plant breeding. Now let us come to the drought tolerant chickpea variety. So recently PM Modi has released these varieties. So these varieties have been developed by ICRISAT in our Hyderabad, and they have produced these elite chickpea cultivar varieties. And why, how they have produced? They have taken a QTL from a particular wild chickpea variety in Madhya Pradesh, and that QTL, which is named at Hotspot because it can enhance the drought tolerant property, they have inserted this QTL into the normal chickpea variety. And what happened that when they obtained the drought tolerant chickpea variety, then they propagated it with classical plant breeding, and in this way they have got this drought tolerant chickpea cultivar. So this is another example of climate resilient crop that has been produced by our scientists. Another thing that is going to be developed, already there is huge work going on, that is climate resilient biofortified maize variety. So climate resilient, we have already understood that it can withstand a high degree of drought, as well as biofortification. It means that value addition has been made to this type of millet. It has been found that these type of millets, they can produce more iron in their grain. So this is called the biofortification. So apart from this more iron producing property, this millet has this tolerant to the drought condition. That's why this is called climate resilient biofortification. So now in a nutshell, what we can see that different type of molecular biological techniques like sequencing, NGS, then phenotyping of gene banks, genomic selection, genome editing, all these can help farmers and scientists are doing this, and they are amalgamating all these techniques, and they are producing very high yielding varieties which are also capable of tolerating very bad weather or climate change. So this is climate change resilient crop development strategy for now. So it means that science is really progressing and really helping in solving the real problems that we have. So here I would like to just shortly present my expertise. In my PhD thesis, I have worked extensively with different type of molecular markers like RAPD, AFLP, then ITS based markers and other isozymes and other markers, and gaining the knowledge on different type of molecular markers, I have extended my research work in my postdoctoral research at Bose Institute. Here, what we have done, we have at this particular lab already in the lab, two different genes from wild variety of rice has been isolated and characterized, and those genes have been introgressed or overexpressed in the normal rice cultivar, that is IR64, and we have developed salt tolerant rice varieties that can withstand very high amount of salt condition in a particular field. So this is our paper on that particular work. And also there we have also found out another very important gene which is responsible for the Calvin cycle reactions, and that gene we cloned from a wild variety of rice, and then that particular gene is introduced transgenically into the indica rice variety, and we tried to develop photosynthetically much more improved rice plant, and we have efficiently did that particular thing. At least in our lab setup, we have found out that our photosynthetically efficient plants, rice plants, are doing very great job in case of salinity condition. So here I am showing some of the research institute of repute in India that is working on this particular topic, and they are doing really great job, like Indian Council of Agricultural Research, the ICAR, then ICRISAT. It is a very good institute, and that particular chickpea varieties are developed by ICRISAT, and then there is Indian Institute of Pulses Research. This is another very important then NIPGR, National Institute of Plant Genome Research. All these are actually working hand in hand, and they are trying to develop these climate resilient varieties, and they have already achieved success in some cases. So I am an optimistic person, so I always feel that one day it will be sunlight again, and we will be thinking that there shall be no hunger and there shall be no such thing called poor thing or poverty, and every single child will smile in near future. So with this I end my presentation, and again I would like to thank the authorities of BioSetup Life Sciences, and a special thank to my student, my ex-student Ananya. She was pretty instrumental in the contact that I have made with BioSetup Life Sciences. So I hope in future we will be doing these type of academic collaborations more and more. And with this, I would like to end my talk now. Thank you very much to all of you. So Is there any question I would like to answer that?
Your participants, if you have any question, you can post your questions in the chat box. So we'll be taking the questions one by one. As of now, there are no questions. So now I would request Argyadeep Das sir to propose the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
I think that one question is there. Sir, how BT genes are specific? This particular question is there from Mohammed Imran.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. So BT or Bacillus thuringiensis, this is a particular gene which is actually it actually codes for a particular toxin. And so whenever this particular BT gene, the BT product actually, it's a toxic product. When it goes inside the gut of the insect, it actually gets dissolved and it actually makes a pore inside the insect gut. And what happens that the insect is died. So this particular property has been checked by scientists, and they developed this BT cotton, this particular crop, with inserting this BT gene with the help of Agrobacterium mediated transformation. So now we have this cotton, which is called BT cotton, and this BT cotton, now when it is planted, if any insect is feeding those cotton leaves, what happens that that particular insect is getting killed by that BT toxin. So in this way, what scientists have achieved, that there is no more invasion of that particular type of insect on cotton plants. So farmers are not losing any crop, and farmers are gaining by developing cotton, and the normal cycle of cotton production, cotton export is going on. So in this way, this BT gene is working. Then Nirjala Gupta is asking that what a role in plant genetic engineering of CRISPR genome.
Darshini, can you please mute yourself? Priya Darshini.
Okay, so what a role plant genetic engineering of CRISPR genomic editing? Very good question, Nirjala. The thing is that this CRISPR technology, this is a very newly developed technology, and it's a technology of gene editing. What this gene editing means, it means that you can now edit this particular plant genome with this CRISPR-Cas. These two components. Now, what is this? This CRISPR. This CRISPR is a guide RNA. This is very bad. Oh, okay. So this CRISPR is a particular sequence. Based on that sequence, you can design your guide RNA, and with that guide RNA, you can combine the Cas. Cas is an enzyme. So this CRISPR Cas, these two thing actually can precisely edit the genome. So now you have this particular tool with which you can easily you put it inside the TI plasmid, and make the TI plasmid get inside the plant genome, and in the plant genome, what will happen? That this CRISPR will go and it will cut precisely the plant genome, and it will edit the genome in the way you want. And in this way, you can develop a transgenic plant. So, and this is very efficient. High number of transformant can be prepared, developed in a very short time. That's why this CRISPR-Cas technology is going to revolutionize the genome editing and all the animal and plant biotechnology. Is BT cotton banned in India? No, it is not banned. Actually, there were several regulatory bodies which actually they protested the commercial release of this particular cotton, but our farmers they cultivated this BT cotton and they have gained huge profit. So it is not banned in such way, but yes, earlier it was, there were some protests related to that. But now what is happening that GM crops are not being released by government. So government has made a policy and they have said that yes, we have developed GM crops. Now it is up to the states whether they will implement those in cultivation or not, whether they will release them in the field or not. So now it is totally, the onus is now on the state. So now in that way, state is totally taking the decision whether it will cultivate the GM variety or not. Anjali Sinha is asking that, sir, can these modified crops can mutate our genes? Will it be safe to consume? Very, very, very important question, Anjali. And what I can say that this is the thing that plant scientists are listening for a long. So whether it can mutate our genes or it can affect our health in adversely. So there is no clear cut answer to this, Anjali. Whenever a particular GM variety is released, before releasing, they check all the different allergenicity and toxicity test for that particular crop variety. So after checking all the toxicity, when they get this, that, well, it is safe to consume, then only these GM varieties are released. Now, what happens that I am telling you that in our country, we are very reluctant to release these GM varieties for several reasons are there. I'm not going to discuss this. But if you go on searching in Google, you will find that in USA, I am only talking about USA. In USA, they are using GM varieties for almost 10 to 20 years back. And they are using them randomly and there is no ill effect. So it is high time for our authorities also to think about this and take a particular guideline about these GM crops. Sir, does consuming GM fruits and vegetables safe because GM crops have the same amount of nutrition as it is in a non-GM crop? Almost similar kind of question, Suyashi. So the thing is that GM fruits, what they say that GM fruits are developed as they have, sometimes they have better nutritious value. So if you take them, you can achieve better nutritious value. Okay, so this is the thing. Riya Sinha, sir, why RAPD is dominant or RFLP is co-dominant? Well, very good question. But to explain that, I need to take a whole class of molecular marker before that. Tell it in a short, that RAPD is a random marker. Random, it is, it's a very short, it's a very short oligomer that with which we are actually amplifying the genome. That's why there is this probability of binding to any part of that genome and amplifying that part. So that's why this is dominant. And whereas RFLP is co-dominant, because RFLP, you are choosing a particular restriction fragment, and based on that restriction fragment, you are developing your probe, and then you are choosing that particular marker, trying to pinpoint the particular marker. So this is generally, this is co-dominant. So sir, what about the presence of heavy metals in the soil like mercury or lead? Is this modified plant climate resistant crops grow? Will there will be any modification in plants? Will there will be bioaccumulation in right? Very good question. So yes, heavy metal tolerating plants are also scientists are also planning to develop heavy metal tolerating plants, in which they are going to put such mechanisms, such genes, which will either will not take up those heavy metals, or if they take up those heavy metals, they will excrete those heavy metals from within the system. So in that way, we can develop heavy metal tolerant resilient crops. So if you search in Google, you will find that several such works are also going on. Sir, how much time modified crops take to show its ill effects? Good question, Anjali. The thing is that already USA is using different GM crops, GM corn. They are consuming for almost 10 to 15 years back, or even more than that. Then GM tomato is there. Then GM other different type of oil producing varieties are there. And there is no such effect, because it has been they are regularly checking the ill effects, or whether these ill effects are there or not, and then only they permit this. And this is in USA system. There is an organization called FDA, and their regulations are very strict. If they found a single thing, one person from a billion of population, if they found anything happen to that particular person, they will stop that production of that particular crop. So till that, I don't find any such report. So we cannot say that what is the average time when it will produce some ill effect. Till date, there is no such. Okay, so I think that no more questions. Will GM plants, Ipshita is asking that, will GM plants lower the fertility of field? Again, this is a thing to study. So exclusively, I can't say that whether it will lower the fertility of field, but certainly it should be studied, and then only we can conclude on that. Sir, what amount of power does GM crops hold? Like, do you think we can grow GM crops on Mars? This I cannot answer right now. Obviously, scientists are trying to do these type of cultivation on space, and there are huge amount of space research is going on. Like, they are trying to develop hydroponic system or aeroponic system with which they can develop crops in space or in other planets. So first they need to develop the normal varieties. Then only we can think of developing GM varieties or cultivating GM varieties to space. Thank you. Thank you, Anjali. Thank you, Ipshita. Thank you, everyone. So I think let's go to the organizers.
Yes,
there
sir.
Must be some kind of, we have already crossed 8:10, right?
Yeah, okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir, and thank you to all the participants. Now I would like to request our founder coordinator, Argyadeep Das, sir, to kindly propose the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Sneha?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay, thank you. So a very good evening to one and all, and my heartfelt thanks to our eminent guest speaker, Dr. Subhendu Bangopadhyay. And I thank you for accepting our invitation for the interactive talk cum webinar. And it was an interactive and indeed awesome session. And you know, the topic of your collection is so useful in this time, because nowadays, due to pollution or external factors causing a global warming, and it changed the climatic conditions, and it may harm the developing crops. So and you know, the way you share your knowledge regarding the topic was so impressive, and because this topic gives me an inside awareness the whole scenario, and literally I was enjoying it and learn a lot of things to boost up my knowledge. And And a big thank you for answering all the questions of with students and researchers community. It was a really a great experience. And so thank you for sparing our precious time and share your knowledge with us. And thank you, sir. And it gives me a immense pleasure to deliver a vote of thanks to today's guest speaker, Dr. Subhendu Bangopadhyay. And also all the participants, once again I thank you, sir, for such an interesting talk and your dedication and work in not only the science and also betterment of scientific society is really commendable and attractive. I'm looking forward for your guidance in future too, sir, and thank you so much. And now my heartfelt thanks to our organizer and event coordinators, Dr. Kavita Pal, Dr. Sudeep Das, organizers Ms. Ananya Devasri, Sneha Mahajan, and Ms. Wrinkle, and Mr. Sreyans, and my dear students and researchers, thank you for joining and invest your precious time for listening the talk and support us. Last but not the least, on the behalf of BioSetup, I thank each and every person for contribution, make this webinar a successful one. And I'm looking forward for arranging many such events to let people know about process made in science. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Dear participants, I'll be